welcome to the Edmonton Bone and Joint Center's Shoulder Replacement Pre-Operative Teaching Session. In this video, you will learn about your shoulder replacement surgery. All of this information can be found in your patient education book. Some of these slides have page numbers on them. You can follow along in your book if you wish. Types of shoulder replacement. You will undergo either a total or a reverse shoulder arthroplasty. In a total shoulder arthroplasty, the ball of the shoulder is replaced with a rounded metal head on a stem. The socket may be replaced with a smooth plastic shell that is curved to fit the new ball. The ball moves in the socket. This joint replacement is meant to mimic your shoulder's anatomy. For a reverse shoulder arthroplasty, a metal stem with a curved plastic shell is put into the arm bone. A metal half sphere is screwed into the socket of the shoulder joint. The socket moves around the ball. This kind of replacement is used in patients with massive rotator cuff tears, severe trauma, or who are undergoing a revision surgery. Goals and expectations. Your surgery is a pain reduction surgery. However, you are not guaranteed to be pain-free. Improvements in range of motion and strength may happen, but are also not guaranteed. You will not be able to throw overhand or do any heavy lifting, pushing, or pulling with your affected arm. Impact activities such as hammering, chopping wood, or chipping ice should be avoided. There are movement precautions you will need to follow after your surgery. You want to protect your new joint. It can wear out and fail over time, and you may need revision surgery. Please ensure you have the following: your shoulder arthroplasty teaching book, your pain management handout, your surgical pathway pamphlet, your goals of care or green sleeve, and finally, your surgical patient agreement. When packing for the hospital, please make sure that you have the following: a small suitcase. You will go home the day of or the day after your surgery. Loose-fitting clothing. A loose-fitting shirt or loose button-up shirt with stretch are best. Adjustable non-slip shoes that will give you good support and can be loosened if your feet swell. Tie-up running shoes work well for this. Personal care items like a toothbrush and toothpaste, soap, deodorant, etc. All prescription medications in their original containers. Do not use your own medication while you are in the hospital. You will be given the medication you need to take while you are in the hospital. Your CPAP machine, if you use one. Your walking aid, if you use one. For example, a walker or a cane. And finally, your teaching booklet. Please make sure to label all of your belongings so that you can keep track of them. Do not bring valuables such as jewelry or credit cards to the hospital with you. Alberta Health Services and Covenant Health are not responsible for any lost or stolen items. Precautions before surgery. Do not have any dental work done 6 to 8 weeks before your surgery. This may result in cancellation of your surgery. Wait until 6 months after surgery. Do not have any injections into your shoulder joint within 3 months of your surgery date. Do not have any pedicures or manicures within 1 week of your surgery, as you could contract an infection. The day before surgery, be sure you have everything that you need for your hospital stay. Go over the surgical patient agreement for your medication instructions, confirm who will be driving you to and from the hospital, follow the eating and drinking guidelines, and if you have questions, please phone the clinic and speak with your case manager. Eating instructions. Eat a final snack before midnight the day before your surgery. This snack may consist of either one small piece of fruit and 1 cup of cereal with 1/2 cup of milk, or one small piece of fruit and 1 slice of toast with jam and 1/2 cup of yogurt. Do not eat anything after midnight. If you do not have diabetes, drink 2 cups or 500 milliliters of clear apple juice or cranberry cocktail 1 hour before your arrival at the hospital. If you do have diabetes, drink 2 cups or 500 milliliters of water 3 hours before your actual surgery time. Follow-up appointments. 1 week after surgery, you will have an appointment with your family doctor for any pain medication refills, as we cannot refill those here. Please book this appointment in advance. Even if you don't end up needing refills, it is better to have this appointment booked and then cancel versus struggling to get an appointment on short notice. You will have follow-up visits after your surgery at the Edmonton Bone and Joint Center or at another clinic, depending on your surgeon. You will have appointments at approximately 2 weeks, 6 weeks, and 3 months after your surgery. What to expect after surgery? Pain and swelling at the surgical site are normal after surgery. This will improve over time. Bear in mind that discomfort is normal, especially with exercise. Use the pain medication you have been prescribed, along with cold therapy, for pain relief. Make sure to take your pain medication if you need it. If you wait too long, it can be very hard to control your pain. Swelling. Use ice packs or cold therapy to control pain and swelling, especially after exercise. Apply an ice pack to your shoulder as needed for 15 to 20 minutes at a time and then remove it. Make sure to use a thin, dry towel between your skin and the cold pack to protect your skin from frostbite. Wait at least 1 hour between applications to allow your shoulder to warm up again. Apply a minimum of 3 times per day or every hour as needed. Active hand and wrist exercises while in your sling can help decrease swelling. You have a few options when it comes to cold therapy. The first is ice packs. Make sure to have several on hand and use the coldest one. Your other option is a cold therapy machine, which can be rented or purchased. There are several types available. Be sure to become familiar with how to use your machine before your surgery. We sell Breg cold therapy units at our Joint Assessment Center for $295. For more information on cold therapy machines, please see page 19 of your surgical booklet. What to expect after surgery? Pain. You will be given pain medication after surgery. Use these medications as prescribed. If you wait too long, it can be very hard to control the pain. The goal is to wean you off of narcotics as soon as you are able to after surgery. Everyone's pain is different, and you may need more pain medication than what you get on discharge from the hospital. This is why we recommend booking an appointment with your family doctor for 1 week after surgery. This appointment will allow you to get the refills on your prescriptions should you need them. Take your pain medications at least 30 to 45 minutes before exercising. Use adjuncts such as Tylenol and Advil to help improve the effectiveness of your pain medication. Potential complications. Blood clots. Although blood clots are rare, they do happen. They can occur in the legs or in the lungs. As such, you want to watch for any signs of blood clots. In the leg, this looks like increased swelling that doesn't go away. Your leg gets red, hot, tight, discolored, and you have calf pain. If any of these symptoms occur, please call your case manager as you may need to go to the ER. Sometimes the clot can travel to your lungs. If you have any chest pain, shortness of breath, or trouble breathing, please call 911 as this is a medical emergency. Potential complications. Infections. Infections are also rare but do happen. When they happen, they can be catastrophic. If you have any of the signs and symptoms of an infection, you should call your case manager right away to have it further assessed if it is business hours. If your incision becomes red, hot, swollen, if there's any foul-smelling drainage or any drainage from your incision, if you have increased pain, fever, or chills, please call your nurse. If your dressing or bandage is not intact or it is leaking, please call your nurse as they can give you dressing change instructions. If you do have an infection, the earlier it is caught, the easier it is to treat. If you are concerned about an infection and it is outside of business hours, please go to the emergency room of the hospital where you had your surgery. The hospital will provide you with instructions about taking care of your bandage or dressing. If your incision is draining and/or leaking for more than 4 days after you leave the hospital, call your case manager. Your staples or sutures will be removed at your first surgical follow-up visit at the 2-week mark. Leave your dressings or bandages intact until this follow-up visit. Bathing and showering. If you have a waterproof dressing, you may shower with your dressing as long as it remains sealed. If you do not have a waterproof dressing, you will sponge bathe until your first follow-up visit. Do not soak in a bath, hot tub, or pool until your sutures or staples are removed and your incision is fully healed. Surgical patient agreement. Your surgical patient agreement includes information regarding your surgery, such as the joint you are being operated on and the hospital that the surgery will take place at. It will also include medication instructions, which will be filled out by the internal medicine doctor. Make sure that you notify your case manager if you have any changes in your health or functional status while you are waiting for your surgery. This includes changes to your medications. Getting ready for surgery. Make sure that you have help at home after surgery. You will need help getting to and from appointments as you will not be able to drive for 6 weeks after surgery. Your support person will be able to stay with you if you live alone, help with your bandages or sling, and assist with housework, yard work, shopping, and making meals as you focus on your recovery. Ask a friend or family member to help you make your home safe and comfortable for recovery. Your physical therapist will talk with you about what equipment you may need to use after surgery. Please let the therapist know if you use your arms to help raise yourself off of the toilet or out of a chair. You will not be able to use your arm to help you stand up or sit down while you're recovering from your surgery, and as such, you may need a raised toilet seat or extra cushion to raise the seat height of your chair. You can make your recovery easier by practicing the exercises at the end of your teaching booklet. These will be your exercises while in the hospital and for your first 6 weeks following surgery. Make sure that you're aware of your post-operative movement precautions, including your external rotation limit. Your post-operative movement precautions can be found at the bottom of your surgical patient agreement. In the hospital, a physical therapist will come see you and review the exercises you will be doing at home. They will also teach you how to take off your sling and put it back on after your exercises. Going home from the hospital. Barring any complications, you can expect to go home either the day of or the day after your surgery. Your surgeon will decide when you are ready to be discharged. You will wake up from surgery with a sling on your operated arm. Expect to wear your sling for up to 6 weeks as directed by your surgeon. During this time, you will not be allowed to drive. This is because you are considered impaired if you are driving while wearing a sling, while taking narcotic pain medication, or if you do not have the functional mobility and strength necessary to drive safely. You must wear this sling even when you are sleeping. Applying your sling. We recommend applying your sling with a pillow on your lap to provide extra support. Once you become more comfortable applying your sling, you can go without it if you so choose. Bend your operated elbow 90 degrees. With your non-operated hand, pull the sling over the operated elbow until your elbow fits snugly into the corner at the back of the sling. At this point, the sling should also cover most of your operated hand. Next, run the strap over your neck and loop it through the hole in the sling above your operated hand and back to it. Tighten any slack in the strap so that the sling provides gentle upward support for your operated arm when you are standing upright. Place the waist strap around your waist and feed the strap through the D-ring below your operated hand. Secure it with Velcro. You may come out of the sling 3 to 4 times per day for washing and simple activities of daily living that occur in front of your body within the box of safety, like brushing your teeth, eating, or writing. You will also remove your sling to do your physical therapy exercises. The box of safety. You can safely perform light activities, keeping your hands within this box of safety without harming your new shoulder. To be clear, your hands need to stay inside this box. For example, activities like eating, knitting, and reading are acceptable. If you are using a computer, if you're using a mouse, ensure that you are using it within this box of safety. You can move outside of the box of safety while doing your home exercises. Sleeping. You will be required to sleep with your sling on. You can sleep on your back or on your non-operated side. Sleeping with your surgical shoulder towards the center of the bed can make it easier to get out of bed. You can roll onto your good shoulder and you will be able to push up using your good side. Support your operated arm with a pillow or folded towels. Do not sleep on or push up with your surgical arm. Dressing. Wearing loose tops or button-up shirts with stretch are best while you're recovering from surgery. When getting dressed, always put your surgical arm into your shirt or coat sleeve first. When undressing, remove your good arm first. Make sure to wear your sling over your clothes. Home exercises. Perform each exercise 2 to 3 times per day. Do 2 sets of 10 repetitions for each exercise. Move within your pain-free limits. Remember that discomfort is normal and okay. All movements of the surgical shoulder must be assisted with a good arm or a cane, broom handle, ski pole, etc. For the first week after surgery, use your good arm to fully assist moving your operated arm for each of these exercises. Once you feel comfortable, you can gently and gradually use the surgical arm to help with the movement. It should be pain-free. Elbow, wrist, and hand exercises. For the first exercise, make a fist and then open the hand fully. For the second, bend the wrist forward and backward like you were knocking on a door. For the third, bend the wrist side to side in a hammering motion. For the fourth, rotate your forearm, alternating between your palm facing upward and downward. For your elbow exercise, first stand with good posture. Then, straighten your elbow as much as you can. Bend your elbow until your fingertips touch your shoulder. Posture and scapular setting. Sit in a chair with good posture, keeping your neck and shoulder muscles relaxed. Your arm can be in your sling or resting on a pillow on your lap. Gently squeeze your shoulder blades together towards your spine and hold for 5 to 10 seconds. Repeat 10 reps. Make sure not to pull your arms back or shrug your shoulders towards your ears as you do this. Pendular exercise. Stand supported beside a table or counter. Bend forward at the waist, allowing your operated arm to hang in front of you. Use the momentum of your body to move your operated arm in circles. Do this clockwise and then counterclockwise. Your circle should be no bigger than the size of a dinner plate. Assisted shoulder flexion. Lay down with your operated shoulder and your elbow supported on a pillow or folded towel. Your forearm should rest on your abdomen with your elbow bent. Then, use your good arm to hold your operated arm just above the wrist or at the elbow. Gently lift your operated arm up towards your head as your pain allows. Assisted shoulder external rotation. Please note that for video purposes, our model did not place a pillow below their head. However, you are welcome to use one when doing these exercises at home. To do the exercise, first lay down with your operated shoulder and elbow supported on a pillow or folded towel and your forearm resting on your abdomen. Your operated elbow should be gently tucked into your side and bent to 90 degrees. Use a cane and your good arm to rotate your operated forearm outward from your body as pain allows, keeping your elbow against your side. Stop when your forearm is vertical. Assisted shoulder scaption. To begin, stand with good posture and set your shoulder blades as we went over in posture and scapular setting. Holding the cane with your good hand, hold the end of the cane in your operated hand as seen here. Use your good arm to push the operated arm away from your side, keeping your hand and elbow about 12 inches in front of your shoulder. Remember to keep your shoulder down as you push your arm up. It should not become shrugged up towards your ear. To be clear, you are not lifting in line with your body, but about 30 degrees in front of it. Return your arm to rest at your side. Shoulder replacement precautions. No lifting, pushing, or pulling with the surgical arm. You cannot lift anything greater than a pound, which is about the weight of a coffee cup, for 6 weeks postoperatively. Be sure to take care when pulling up your pants and socks. No external rotation beyond the limit set by your surgeon for 6 weeks. As part of your surgery, your surgeon may have repaired your subscapularis muscle. Your external rotation limit will protect the muscle repair and allow it to heal. Keep all active, unassisted movement inside the box of safety. Shoulder replacement precautions. Do not reach with your arm behind you for 6 weeks postoperatively. No putting your hand in your back pocket or tucking your shirt in behind you, washing or toileting behind your back. Take care when pulling up your pants and get help tucking in your shirt behind your back. No weight bearing through the surgical arm for 6 weeks post-op. This means no pushing yourself up out of bed, out of a chair, or off the toilet with your operated arm. If you do use a walker, rest the hand of the operated arm on the walker for balance only. Do not lean on it. Do not actively rotate your arm inward towards your stomach, aka internal rotation, for 6 weeks postoperatively. Do not pull against resistance, rotating in toward your stomach for 3 months. Do not close doors rotating in towards your stomach, especially glass sliding doors, vehicle doors, or heavy doors. Be careful when you hug someone. Make sure to hug gently and do not squeeze them. No excessive stretching. Dislocation precautions. No combined shoulder abduction and external rotation for 3 months. This means no hand behind your head or your neck with your elbow pulled back, no overhand throwing position, and no reaching over the back of a chair or into the back seat of your vehicle. Returning to normal activity. For desk work or work requiring little to no use of the operated arm, you can return to work as soon as you feel ready. For leisure activities and work requiring moderate to heavy use of the operated arm, discuss a timeline with your surgeon. Like we outlined in our expectations/guidelines slide, the following activities should be avoided. These include heavy lifting, pushing, and pulling with your operated shoulder, impact activities such as hammering, chopping wood, or chipping ice, carrying heavy loads with your arms outstretched. The weight or load should be kept close to the body. In general, more demanding activities will increase the wear on your shoulder replacement. Heavy or aggressive use may increase your risk of excessive wear or loosening. If your replacement wears out and fails, you may need a revision surgery. Thank you for taking the time to watch this presentation. If you have any questions, please contact your surgical team or call our front desk at 780-433-3155. If your question is physical therapy related, please call 780-377-1431 or 780-377-1432.
Did you know that the nose is home to thousands of germs? In fact, it's an ideal breeding ground for many bacteria, viruses, and fungi. These include harmful infection-causing germs like influenza, coronaviruses, Staph aureus, and MRSA. As we breathe and touch our faces, these germs easily spread not only to other areas of our bodies, but also to surfaces and people around us. Even as we clean our hands, bodies, and other surfaces, the germs in our noses keep spreading and recontaminating these areas. This exposes us to potentially serious infections when we have a wound, a surgical incision, or a weakened immune system. But what if these harmful germs could be eliminated before they leave the nose? Introducing Steriwave Nasal Photodisinfection by Ondine Biomedical. Steriwave is a painless, 5-minute treatment that uses a special light-activated liquid that's scientifically referred to as a photosensitizer to safely destroy bacteria, viruses, and fungi living in the nose, including superbugs, while keeping your human cells unharmed. Here's how it works. First, the nostrils are swabbed with the Steriwave photosensitizer. Like a magnet, the photosensitizer, which has a positive electrostatic charge, attaches itself immediately to germs, which have a negative charge. In contrast, human cells have no charge. At this point, nothing's happening yet. Then, the nostrils are illuminated with a Steriwave light. This specific red light is safe, unlike UV light. When the photosensitizer is activated by this light, it creates a cascade of reactive oxygen molecules that physically tears apart the germs. Our own immune system produces these same molecules to fight infections, but Steriwave does so much faster and in much greater quantity. Bacteria, viruses, and fungi are simply unable to defend themselves or develop resistance. When the light turns off, the reaction stops. As soon as the Steriwave treatment is finished, the nose is sanitized and germs can no longer spread to contaminate other areas and cause infection in ourselves or others. While there's a lot of science and engineering behind this world-leading non-antibiotic alternative, It's quick and easy to use, and it's already been proven in leading hospitals to significantly reduce infection rates, length of stay, readmissions, and antibiotic use. Painless, safe, powerfully effective in minutes, even against superbugs. Steriwave nasal photodisinfection. Strike infections before they start.